Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In our traditional services this weekend, we sang the popular refrain, "Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before." Is that what we are? Christian soldiers marching off to do battle with the enemy? Throughout the scriptures, there certainly seem to be indications of this reality of life in the church militant. Perhaps the best example is when Jesus says, "And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Gates, of course, are defensive weapons, and so if the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church, Jesus implies that the church is storming the gates of hell. But not in Ephesians 6. In our epistle lesson today, the posture of the Christian soldier is not one of offense, but of defense. If we want a picture from a Bible story, Ephesians 6 is not like Joshua and the armies of Israel taking the land of Canaan, you know, walking around the walls of Jericho, blowing their trumpets and the walls coming down. It's more like the righteous King Hezekiah holding out in Jerusalem against the siege of the Assyrian army, waiting for the angel of the Lord to do battle with his enemy. Our marching orders in Ephesians 6 are not to march at all. Rather, Paul tells the church to do one thing, to stand. To stand. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. In verse 13, Paul encourages us again to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. And then in verse 14, he says, "Stand therefore." Not charge, certainly not retreat, but stand. In Exodus 14, the children of Israel were caught between the advancing Egyptian army and the Red Sea. They were stuck. They had no place to go, and they cried out to God and Moses, questioning why Yahweh would deliver them from slavery in Egypt just to have them massacred on the beach. But then Moses spoke a powerful word. He said, "Fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians that you see today, you shall never see again." God did not tell them to fight. He didn't tell them to flee. He told them to stand. And then Moses stretched out his staff, parting the waters of the Red Sea. The Israelites crossed to safety on dry ground. And after the Egyptian army pursued them, the waves came back to where they were before, drowning the entire Egyptian force. The Lord worked salvation for them that day because the battle belongs to the Lord. And all they had to do was stand and watch. So stand. Not only must we be mindful of our orders to stand, but we also need to remember who the enemy is. Not people. Inarguably, American culture has changed, and our postmodern relativistic culture is very hostile to Christianity. There's little love in our general culture for Orthodox Christianity anymore. And we can try to parse all of the sociological and political and theological reasons for it. We can get ourselves worked up by listening to all the talking heads on the cable news channels. But the reality remains that our real enemies are not human beings. Whether they're the promoters of political correctness, political parties, politicians, Hollywood, the NFL, foreign dictators, or even Islam. And while it is true that Satan uses wicked people for his purposes, our real enemies are still not flesh and blood. The Apostle Paul reminds us that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. See, ever since the serpent slithered into view and tempted Eve to question God's word and eat the forbidden fruit, we have been in a pitched battle against the hordes of hell. Unfortunately, most people, including Christians, deny the existence of the devil today. According to research by the Barna Group, only about a third of American Christians, not the general population, only about a third of American Christians believe that Satan is an actual malevolent entity. They see him more as just kind of a symbol for evil. And yet the devil and his minions are real. Paul calls them rulers, authorities, cosmic powers, spiritual forces of evil. This present darkness is a real threat. The demons continually assault our consciences with temptations, with guilt, with fear and despair. The name Satan means accuser. And Satan accuses our conscience night and day, trying to get us to give up on our faith and give in to his schemes. And he is ruthless. The Apostle Peter says that our adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Pray that you don't become prey. To that end, keep alert with perseverance. Against this fearsome enemy, it might appear that we're mercilessly outmatched, but the Bible says if God is for us, who can be against us? Satan may have his demon hordes, but we have the God of angel armies on our side. I'm reminded of an obscure battle in 2 Kings chapter 6. And in that passage, the king of Israel trembles in fear when he gazes out upon the Syrian forces that are arrayed against him. The prophet Elisha's servant is also afraid, but Elisha cheers him by saying, "Do not be afraid, because those who are with us are more than those who are with them." Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And then he prays that the young man would see the truth. And the Bible says, the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The Lord struck the Syrian army with blindness. Israel was delivered, and they won that battle without killing a single man. Just as Jesus does not leave us alone in the field of battle, so also he does not leave us defenseless. In fact, he arms us with the very best weapons of war. St. Paul writes, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." Now, in your bulletin, I provided an illustration for you of the armor of God. This is from the Rose Book of Bible Maps, Charts, and Timelines. Last night, a lot of people were missing it. So, can you just hold it up so I know that you have it? And then I can, all right, then I feel better. All right, very good. So, let's take a quick equipment inventory. First of all, we have the belt of truth. God's word is truth, and so is Jesus. He calls himself the way and the truth and the life. And so as Christians, we are armed with God's truth, and we don't pay attention to the ways of the world or the opinions of men. We are grounded in God's word that is girded about us. Next is the breastplate of righteousness, protecting our heart. And unfortunately, the description on your sheet is probably not the best one. It says, righteousness is being honest, good, humble, and fair to others. It means standing up for weaker people. And certainly we would hope that a Christian would be honest, good, humble, fair to others, sticking up for weaker people. But the reality is that the breastplate of righteousness that guards our heart is not earned. It's given. And in Greek and Latin, the word for righteousness in the Bible is related to the word justified. To be justified means to be made right with God, to be declared righteous by his fiat. According to Romans 3:28, we hold that one is justified, one is made righteous by faith apart from works of the law. And so we're not righteous because we do these good things, but because Christ has made us good. You are saved by grace through faith. It's not your own doing, it's the gift of God. And so what guards our heart is the righteousness that Christ won for us and delivered to us. Not what we supposedly do for ourselves. And so that breastplate of righteousness is the righteousness that Jesus won for you. The next piece of armor is the gospel shoes, the readiness given by the gospel of peace. And the gospel is the good news that Christ died for our sins and gives us eternal life, not because we deserve it, but because he loves us. And so also then we are ready to share this good news with other people in order to comfort their consciences and to assure them of God's salvation. And so our feet are always ready with those gospel shoes. Our greatest defense against the devil's attack is the shield of faith. And faith is a gift from God. Faith clings to the promises of God. It believes and receives his forgiveness. And when the devil is at his worst, firing all of his flaming missiles at you, it is your faith in Christ that gives you your defense as it blocks those attacks. I have to make a horrible joke here. Some of you remember Pastor Kaltoff, right? That was the interim pastor between me and Pastor Mark. And in one translation, the NIV, it calls these the fiery darts of the devil. And one time when he was preaching on that, he misspoke. He flipped his initial consonants and he said, the diary farts of the devil. And we want to watch out for those too. And I think that our shield of faith is up to the task. The helmet of salvation is what protects our heads. We've been given the mind of Christ. And so we don't think about things, we don't see things in the same way that the world does. The Word of God guides our thoughts and speech so that we seek the things that are above where Christ is. And finally, we come to our last weapon. It's that sword. It's our only offensive weapon, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. By the way, Roman soldiers were usually equipped with two swords. One was a long sword, one was a short sword called a gladius. And there is debate among Bible scholars about which of these Paul is referring to. The short sword was actually more of a defensive weapon. And so there are some who say that all the armor of God is defensive. It would be kind of like thinking about the difference between having a dagger or a tactical knife versus a sword or a bayonet. But the point is that the sword of the Spirit is God's word. And in the book of Revelation, God's word is said to come out of Christ's mouth like a mighty sword. In the book of Hebrews, we're told that God's word is sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing to the separation of spirit and soul. I don't know about you, but I'm not sure where spirit ends and soul begins, but that is how fine God's word is, how sharp it is at being able to bring the truth. And that same word has been entrusted to us. It points us to Christ, our hero, the defender of our faith. And these are the weapons that Christ has given us. They are the gifts of God. We don't earn them, we don't win them, we can't purchase them. They are ours by right of our baptism. In fact, the very language of putting on the armor of God also has the meaning of being clothed in other parts of the New Testament. And that idea of being clothed is often used to talk about baptism, to talk about the putting off of the old sinful self and the putting on of Christ. Because in baptism, we are clothed with Christ. We are clothed with the righteousness of Jesus that covers our sin. We are armed. We are outfitted with the armor of God, the weapons of the Spirit. And so from our baptism on, we stand firm against the devil and his schemes, because Christ has clothed and armored us with himself. And indeed, the only reason, the only way that we can stand against the devil is because Jesus stands with us. The same one who took his stand at the cross, where he destroyed the works of the devil, where he chained the dragon forever. The good news for us in our spiritual warfare is that even though the devil is called a raging dragon and a dangerous lion, he is chained. Martin Luther likened Satan to an angry, rabid dog that's tied to a tree. And he may bark, and he may growl, and he may foam at the mouth and slaver, but he cannot harm you unless you get too close. But the devil is tied up. And ever since the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, Satan is a chained dragon. He is a caged lion. And so no matter what he throws at you, stand. Stand. Because we don't have to strategize. We don't have to figure out how to win the war. The victory is done. The battle is won. From the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." And so it is. So be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.